to be visited by Nick Elmonde, who's visiting us from TIFR. He's a graduate student working on computational complexity and more specifically, I guess, communication complexity and circuit complexity, advised by Arkadev Champadai. And today he'll tell us about some communication complexity related results about threshold.
Thanks,
Dan.
I hope I'm audible. Yeah, again, thanks for organizing and short notice time. Thank you for attending this thing. So today, I'll be talking on this result. Like Ryan said, it's a communication complexity slash circuit complexity result. The title being a short list of equalities and induces large sign rank. So it is based on recent work with Arkadev Chattopadhyay, who's my advisor. Public version of this is available under a different title. Well, I could link you later on. Okay, so here's the outline of what I'll be talking about. I will try to make clear all terms in the title as the talk progresses. Please feel free to stop me whenever to ask questions. So I'll start with what is sign rank. It's a sort of measure of matrices and why it's useful and some equivalent notions. Then I'll talk a bit about depth to threshold circuits. So this is the circuit complexity part and why sign rank is of importance in analyzing these classes. So I'll conclude this section by our main result in the circuit complexity side, which separates two depth to circuit classes. And in order to prove a separation, we need a function which is in the class above. So we need to identify a candidate hard function. I'll try to talk about that in this third part. And then I'll follow up with some communication complexity class separation. So this is the communication complexity part. And so basically the main theorem is saying that the sign rank of some matrix or some function is large. And I'll conclude with the proof outline, a sort of sketch, quick sketch of the proof, and some conclusions. Okay, so what's the sign rank of a matrix? Let's assume you have a plus minus one valued matrix. And what I do is I permit you to make changes to the entries of the matrix. You're allowed to perturb them to any real, as long as you preserve the signs of all the entries. So you're allowed to change Mij to any Aij such that the sign of Aij is. I'll show you an example here. Let's say you started with this matrix M, and sorry, the sign rank is the minimum possible rank you can obtain doing such transformations. So this matrix M, it's easy to check that it has rank 4. And now I'm also demonstrating that sign rank can be significantly lower than the rank in general. Let's look at this matrix A. If you just look at it, it's all the entries correspond in sign with the corresponding entries in M. And one can check that the rank of this matrix is 2. And in fact, it's not hard to show that there's no matrix of rank 1 which sign agrees with M. So the sign matrix, sign rank of this matrix M is 2, whereas rank is 4. So again, please stop me if anything's unclear. So let's look at another interpretation of sign rank, a geometric interpretation. So it's also equivalent to this notion of dimension complexity of the matrix. What does that mean? Let's see. So what is it? So suppose the sign rank of this matrix was D. So in this case it's 2. What does that mean? That there's a sign agreeing matrix A, as showed on this slide. This is the same matrix I'm considering. And the rank being 2 means there's a 4 cross 2 matrix and a 2 cross 4 matrix such that P times H is equal to A. Just definition of rank. So P times H is a matrix which sign agrees with M on all entries. one can interpret this in this way. Look at the rows of P as points in R2 in this case. So this P1, 1, 0 is 1, 2, and so on. And view the columns of H as the normals to hyperplanes in R2. Any column is just uniquely identifies a hyperplane passing through the origin with a direction. Okay, and P times H, so let's say P, the ith row of P times jth row of H, the sign of that essentially tells us which side of the hyperplane P is lying on. So you're asking for a minimum dimension of a Euclidean space, such that you can embed points and hyperplanes such that the pairwise inner product agrees in, it embeds correctly. So the pairwise inner product agrees in sign with this original. So this is the dimension combination. We won't be using this notion later, but this is just an interesting observation. So where does sign rank have applications? So most of this talk will be devoted towards trying to prove sign rank lower bounds for matrices. So it turns out that sign rank lower bounds imply lower bounds in Boolean circuit complexity, unbounded error communication complexity, and sign rank upper bounds also have some applications in computational learning theory. So through this talk, I'll just be talking about these first two points. So okay, now let me just jump into depth to threshold circuits, and towards the end, I'll try to tell you why sign rank lower bounds imply lower bounds. Yeah. So any questions so far? So what is a linear threshold gate? So a function is a linear threshold function. If you can associate with it weights, Wi's, such that the function is true if and only if this threshold criterion is satisfied. Let's look at a simple example of a linear threshold function. Let's say the AND function. So the AND on n bits, suppose your inputs are all 0, 1 valued, Boolean valued, and the output is 0, 1 valued for now. So the AND function is just checking so AND is true, AND is 1, if and only if summation xi, I equals 1 to n, is greater or equal to n, right? That's the only case when AND is true. And OR is true if and only if summation xi is greater or equal to 1. At least one of them is true. So linear threshold function sort of generalizes these two. So because the input domain is discrete, with an argument you can show that you can perturb the weights such that they are assumed to be integers. In general, they could be reals. And you could also assume that their magnitudes are not too large. Exponentially large, but still not too large, two to the order n. So let's denote the class of all functions computable by this sort of gate. So like I said, AND and OR included. Let's denote the class of such functions, LT1. And the class LT1 hat, where all the weights are polynomially bounded. Okay, another example is the majority function. So the majority function is just one that outputs 1. If the majority of the inputs is 1. The corresponding linear threshold representation is summation xi greater than n by 2 or greater or equal to n by 2, depending on how. So note that all the weights I've been talking about in the AND, OR, and majority are just either constant or n. In this case, yeah. So does LT1 really give us more power over LT1 hat? So throughout this section, whenever I have a hat, it will be like polybounded weights, and no hat means unrestricted weights, though I will mention it again. Okay. So if you look at this greater than function, which is, let's say, a function on 2 n bits, and the function outputs 1 if the integer corresponding to the binary representation of the first n bits is greater than the integer corresponding to the second n bits. That's the greater than function. it's not hard to show that this requires exponential weight. So large weights do matter when you look at just single linear threshold functions. So everyone has this tricks up to that. In fact, Hostad showed in 94 that there are weights that require 2 to the omega n log n weight. So there are functions that require this weight. So that means the bound shown on the previous slide here is tight. But linear threshold functions are not as powerful as we would hope. It can't even compute simple functions like the parity function. So the parity function is just one that takes sums up the input bits and outputs one if and only if the sum is odd. So basically sums outputs the parity of the inputs. Minsky and Papert showed that parity can't be computed by linear threshold functions.
The weights are positive and negative.
Right, let's say real, yeah. Positive and negative. Okay. Now, let's see what happens if we compose gates. So a single linear threshold is hard. It has hard functions. That's a parity. What happens when you compose another layer of thresholds here? So you have a threshold of threshold. So this is what it is. You have a bunch of inputs feeding into a layer of threshold gates, and all of them feed into a single threshold gate. So let's denote by LT2 the class of all functions which are computable by a poly-sized threshold of threshold. Okay. So like we said, parity can't be computed by LT1. Turns out parity can be computed by, in fact, linear-sized threshold of threshold. And this can even compute every symmetric function, which is functions of the Hamming weight of the input, parity, majority, and all. So I will interchangeably use LT2 and threshold of threshold. I'm going to mean the same thing. Turns out we don't have lower bounds against LT2. So this is one of the smallest natural circuit classes against which we don't have explicit lower bounds. Sort of baffling why we don't. But we do have a candidate hard function, luckily, which is the inner product function. And let me describe it for you. It's a function on 2n bits. Pair them up into n pairs. Take the ands of each pair. So x1 and y1 gives you z1 and so on. And take the parity of the resulting bits. And that gives you the inner product mod 2 function. Okay. So it's conjectured that this function cannot be computed by polynomial size LT2 circuits, threshold of threshold circuits. Unfortunately, the current best known lower bound against threshold of threshold circuits is result due to Kane and Williams, which says you require size n to the 3 halves to compute threshold inner product using threshold of threshold circuits. Yeah.
So is inner product like trivially available to reason?
So inner product is, like I said, XOR of AND. And as mentioned before, so XOR is parity. It can be computed by LT2. So it's LT2 of AND, and AND is just a threshold. In fact, it turns out you don't need the unbounded weights. It's just in majority of majority of majority, and polybounded weights.
Size just the number of?
I should have mentioned this. When I refer to size, I'm going to refer to the number of gates.
Is it easy to see why parity is in LT2?
It's a nice exercise, let me say that. I won't be able to show it online now, but the idea is parity is in majority of majority, where the idea is you want to use the bottom layer majorities to somehow identify the Hamming weight of the input, and the top layer is going to help you in some way. That's the idea. I could tell you off there. I'll need to come up with that argument myself. Nice question. Thanks. Okay. Okay, now let's talk about some natural subclasses of LT2, and let's see if we have lower bounds against them. So one natural subclass is, suppose, so like I said, in LT1 we restricted the weights to be poly, and we had a separation between those two classes, the greater than function. So suppose all your weights are bounded by poly n. This is going to yield the class majority of majority. You might as well assume that the weights are 1. All the gates are majorities. This is not too hard. So, like I said, hat is going to denote poly weights. So, majority of majority polynomial functions computable by polynomial size of majority of majority circuits. Let's call it LT2 hat. Or also informally, I'll be calling them majority. We can similarly define majority of threshold, threshold of majority, where the corresponding layer has polybounded weights and the other has unbounded weights. Okay. Now, so since LT2, we don't know any limitations against it, let's take a look at what do we know against these classes, majority of threshold, threshold of majority. So, Goldman-Rosta, they proved in 92 this sort of amazing result that majority of majority is actually equal to majority of threshold. So, any majority of threshold circuit can be, you just incur a polynomial blow up in the size and you can convert it into a majority of majority circuit. And they also showed that this class is strictly contained in threshold of majority. Hainal et al. In 93 showed that inner product cannot be computed by poly size majority of majority. And there's sort of a communication bottleneck there. So the idea is that any majority of majority circuit can be communicated with them. So I'm not going to formally define this, but in some sense, which turns out to be discrepancy, but inner product doesn't have good discrepancy. This is the idea of showing it.
Yeah, sorry, I missed the definition of majority. Are you talking about the majority function, or are you talking about just like poly bounded weights?
Think of them as equivalent right now. Just think of it as majority function. Even if I was talking about poly bounded weights, you could like sort of duplicate the inputs and assume it to be an actual majority. Just what we said. So this communication lower bounds yields lower bounds against majority of majority. Foster in 2001 had a breakthrough result, which yields lower bounds against threshold of majority circuit size. So this is where sign rank comes in the picture in depth through threshold circuits. He basically said that Foster proved that the sign rank of a matrix is at least 2 to the n times the corresponding, this should be the sign rank. I should mention this before. So when you have a function on 2n bits, we can think of the corresponding communication matrix, let's call it, in which the rows are indexed by all possible x inputs, these first inputs, the columns are indexed by the second. So x and y. So the rows are indexed by x inputs, columns by y inputts, and the x comma y entry is just f of x y. So let's call this matrix M of f. Foster showed that the sign rank of a function, by which I mean the sign rank of the corresponding matrix, is at least lower bounded by the inverse of the spectral norm of the matrix. And yeah.
Sorry, this is like a 2 to the n by 2 to the n matrix?
Yes. And not too hard corollary is that threshold of majority circuits have small sign rank. So basically that means sign rank lower bounds the threshold majority circuit size. And once we have this result, it's not hard to analyze the spectral norm of the inner product mod 2 matrix, which turns out to be a Hadamard matrix. And you get, as a corollary, any threshold of majority circuit computing inner product mod 2 must have exponential size, 2 to the n sizes. So to recap, we don't know limitations. Okay, I think I'll have it here. So greater than is a function which requires exponential weight and is cannot be computed by poly weight. Parity is a function that separates LT1 from majority of majority. Goldman, Ostad, Rasparov, they showed all of these inclusions. So they showed, in fact, majority of majority is equal to majority of threshold, strictly in threshold majority, and threshold of majority naturally is in threshold of threshold. And they also showed threshold of threshold is in majority of threshold. So like I said, we have lower bound techniques of all classes up to here. And one major, one long-standing open question is to prove explicit lower bounds against LT2, like I said. So let's recall that inner product is not in threshold of majority, like I showed on the previous slide, since it has large sign rank. So sign rank lower bound threshold of majority surfaces. And it is, in fact, in majority of majority of majority, like I said earlier. So that means one of these two containments is strict. One may, I mean, there's a chance that there was a chance that threshold of majority equals threshold of threshold, especially given the result which I mentioned on the previous page and also this. Majority of majority is equal to majority of threshold. So for all we know, threshold of majority might have equaled threshold of threshold. So in fact, Amano and Maruoka and Hansen and Podolsky explicitly posed this question, sort of indicating, is threshold of majority a strict subset of threshold? And like I mentioned on the previous page, it's on the previous slide, it's not even clear whether they ought to be different or same. And there's no candidate Hart function identified, unlike, like inner product is a candidate Hart function to be outside threshold of threshold. So even if you wanted a separation, you would have to identify a candidate Hart function. So this is, in joint work with Arkadev Chattopadhyay, we show a function in threshold of threshold, which has exponentially large sign rank. So which means it can't be computed by, any threshold of majority circuit computing it must have this much size. So that means these classes are indeed different. Now in comparison to this result, while weights at the bottom do not matter if the top is light, they do matter if the top is heavy. So this is essentially the title of the version you'll find online. Okay, so that concludes my depth to circuit, threshold circuit part. Any questions on this section? Okay, so now let's talk about how do we identify a function in threshold of threshold which has large sign rank. So like I said, there's no candidate, so we need to come up with a candidate. In order to do that, we view one equivalent notion of sign rank. So there's a model, there's a communication complexity notion called unbounded error communication complexity, which is equivalent to the sign rank, which I'll come to in a while. And let me sort of quickly go through the model of communication we work with. So I'm going to describe what a protocol for a function is. So Alice and Bob are given inputs X and Y and access to private randomness RARB. On their own, they're computationally unbounded, but they wish to compute a function of both the inputs. And how are they allowed to do that? By communicating. So Alice sends Bob a message N1, which is a function of X and RA. Bob replies with M2, which is a function of M1, Y, and RB, and so on until they get the answer. Let's say MK is constrained to be the output. So this output is either 0 or 1. That's what we call pi of XY. And the number of bits communicated is K. So let's say a protocol has advantage epsilon if basically for all inputs, the probability of being correct is at least half plus epsilon. and let R epsilon F denote the cost of the cheapest epsilon advantage protocol. And UPP is the inf of R epsilon F. So what does this mean? I tell you that you just have to do barely better than random guessing. So what would random guessing do? Suppose Alice and Bob are given inputs X, Y, and this is output 0 with probability half, 1 with probability half. So the probability of being pi equaling F would be exactly half in that case. And what you want now is just to be strictly greater than half. That's it. So like, this is a very strong model against which we don't really know of lower bound. So Paturi and Simon showed in the mid-80s that this UPP cost of F is equivalent to the sine rank. So it's equal to the log of the sine rank of the corresponding matrix. And this is the view which will help us identify candidate hard function. Okay. So recall, we wanted a function in threshold of threshold with large sine rank. That was a main theorem. Like I said on the previous slide, that's equivalent to showing a function in threshold of threshold with large UPP cost, unbounded error communication context. Now, this is naturally candidate. So there is a linear threshold function called the universal threshold function, which is basically a function on n square bits, such that it simulates every linear threshold function on n bits by setting variables. So UTHR of UTHR sort of contains every possible linear threshold of linear threshold. And if there were indeed a function in threshold of threshold with large UPP cost, this hash will have large UPP cost too. But I mean, it's a bit too unstructured to analyze. So let's try to make the function simpler. Let's look at what a natural unbounded error protocol for such a function is. So you have a threshold, and feeding into it is a bunch of disjoint copies of a function f, let's say. What's a natural unbounded error protocol? Let's sample one of the inputs to the threshold at random. So if the weights corresponding to the inputs were wi, sample the ith input proportional to the weight wi. And Alice sends Bob the sampled index. And they basically run a deterministic protocol for F, let's say deterministic. And that would give you a protocol with polylog cost, because Alice, this message just takes log n many polylog bits. It's just the fan in of the threshold. And suppose F could be solved easily deterministically. It's still polylog cost, and this sampling sort of incurs an error, so it gives us advantage greater than half, but you can't say anything better than that. It's strictly greater than half is all you can say. So at the least, F has to be hard to communicate deterministically, and if you attended a course on communication complexity, one of the first functions you see which is hard for deterministic communication is equality. So Alice and Bob are given X and Y, and they wish to check whether the strings are equal or not. So turns out the threshold of equality, in fact, can be simulated by threshold of threshold. Requires an argument, but it's not hard. Now let's see if we can simplify the top threshold as well. Let's look at this odd max bit function. It's a well-studied linear threshold function. It's a function on n bits. Look at the largest index of a bit, which is 2, and output the parity of that, basically. So this gives us our target hard function, odd max bit of equality. Now let's look at another view of it. So odd max bit, it turns out, is equivalent to this notion of a decision list. What's a decision list? It works in the following way. On input x, it queries some function f1 of x. If that's 1, then you output the bit a1. Else, query f2 of x. If that's 1, output a2, and so on. And let's say al is let's say FL is the constant true function. So in our function, the odd max bit of equality function, these FIs are just equality checks on L to the 1/3 bit strings. I haven't mentioned this parameter yet. And all equalities being on disjoint variables. This sort of captures the odd max bit, the odd part. So this is a function which we're going to show that has large sign rank. Like I mentioned on the previous slide, it is in threshold of threshold. Any questions so far? So I hope this justifies the title at least. So it's a polynomial, it's a L length, it's a L list of equalities, and we're going to show that it has large sign rank. So now let me talk about communication complexity class separation. So I already talked about threshold circuit class separations. So I already mentioned the class UBP. And let's look at all functions that have efficient protocols. So Babai Frankel and Simon in the mid 80s, they argued that Turing machine complexity classes have natural analogs in the communication complexity world, and where poly time as a notion of efficiency just corresponds to poly log communication. So a lot of questions that are posed in the Turing machine world can also be asked in the communication world, and some more stuff is known in the communication world. For example, P not equals NP here, but this is actually pretty easy to show in the communication. Anyway, so it turns out UPP CC, I'm going to drop the subscript for convenience. But turns out that this is a natural analog of the Turing machine class PP, so probabilistic polytime. Yeah. So recall that I just told you that the unbounded error complexity of F is essentially the log of the sign rank of the matrix, and sign rank is lower bounded by the inverse of the spectral norm of that matrix. And like I said, this was the same argument which I told you, inner product is not in threshold of majority, it's also not in UPP. So UPP is one of the strongest, or probably the strongest communication complexity class against which we have a lower bound technique. So we don't know of any natural class which contains UPP, and we don't know of a lower bound technique. So what are the limits of UPP? So it's Rasparov and Shostov showed in 2010 that sigma 2. So now I'm talking purely about the communication complexity class. I'm not talking about Turing machine classes. So they showed that sigma 2 is not in UPP. There's a function in sigma 2 with large sign rank. So a natural question is, against what classes does the sign rank method suffice to prove? How strong is the sign rank method? Towards this, Gus Pitassi and Watson conjectured in 2016 the following two classes, which they conjectured to have functions of large sign rank. One was AM intersection CoAM. So by the way, AM is another class for which we do not know lower bounds in the communication complexity world, and this is also a long-standing question. And the other was S2P. The first conjecture was proved very recently by Boulan et al. And our function actually witnesses the second separation. We in fact show this class P to the MA, which I will be defining shortly, is strictly contained. There is a function in it of large sign rank, so it's not contained in UPP. So P to the MA is known to be in S2P. So I'm not defining S2P. We'll just work with this non-containment. So now let me try to motivate, tell you a bit more about P to the MA and why this non-containment is important. So I'll quickly recap what MA is. MA is a natural generalization of NP, where there's a prover, and now he's in the communication world, so I'll need to formally tell you what Arthur does, because there are two people. So Merlin, the prover, has access to Alice and Bob's inputs. He sends a proof string to them based on the inputs. And Alice and Bob together, they run a randomized protocol. This is essentially the Arthur version of the communication world. And we require this correctness that for all inputs, the protocol must output the correct answer with probability 2/3. And the cost of the protocol is just the number of bits communicated here in the worst case, plus the length of the proof string. So let's look at an MA protocol for this function, or of equality. Suppose there are L many equalities and each equality is on M bits. What's an MA protocol? Merlin looks at X and Y and indicates an index M, which basically he's trying to indicate that this the equality here is true. Let's say the 42nd index. And this Merlin's proof string just takes log L many bits. He just has to indicate an index. And Alice and Bob just run a standard randomized protocol for equality. So the total cost of this is just log M, and yeah, so it's an MA protocol. And the correctness is not hard to verify. So what is P to the MA? It's just deterministic protocols with access to MA oracles. So it's known, like I said, P to the MA is in this class S2P, which is inside the Pi to P, the second level, basically, of the hierarchy. Now let me tell you what a P to the MA protocol for odd max bit of equality, or your decision list of equalities is. So recall that the odd max bit function looks for the largest index input, which is 2, and outputs the parity of that index. So let's do a sort of binary search. Look at the second half of equalities. Use an MA oracle to query the OR of equality of this. Suppose it's false. And then go to the first half, and then so on. So the binary search takes log many steps. And Alice and Bob just need to check the equality of this if it's, yeah. So basically, they know the index at which this equality is 1, the largest index, and they output the parity of that. So like I said, this is the function for which we showed sine rank lower bounds. So it is in P to the MA, but it's not in UPP. And let's try to relax P to the MA slightly. Like I said, MA is a natural generalization of NP. So P to the NP is in P to the MA. And also, what if you just remove this oracle access and look at the class MA? MA is also in P to the MA. Well, these containments are known. MA is strictly in UPP. P to the NP is strictly in UPP. And there are lower bound techniques known against both of these classes. So a natural program that arises is to show lower bounds or lower bound techniques against this class P to the MA. Right. Questions? Okay, I guess now I'll quickly talk about the proof outline. Now, in order to for our analysis, it helps to view our function as an XOR function. So let me tell you about what XOR functions are. Suppose you have a function f on n bits. The function f of XOR is just defined on 2 n many bits. Just pair up the input variables to the XOR and feed them into f. Why are XOR functions important? So it's extensively studied, at least under various models of communication and other areas too. Hatami Hosseini Lovett recently showed that the deterministic communication complexity of f of XOR is polynomially related to the parity decision tree complexity of f. In another work with Arkadev, we showed that the discrepancy of, which is sort of the weakly unbounded error model communication complexity of f of XOR, is actually delimited by a constant to an approximation theoretic notion called the polynomial margin of error. So I won't get into this. It also shows interesting connections in Fourier analysis. So if you look at the matrix, the communication matrix of f of XOR, and it turns out that its eigenvalues are just the Fourier coefficients of f. The favored log-rank conjecture is even open for the special class of XOR functions. So it would be a nice step towards proving the log-rank conjecture if you could prove it for the special class. There have been only two, so like I said, we're going to show an unbounded error complexity lower bound against an for an XOR function. And there have only been two recent works on this topic, which were by Hatami Chian and Atta Fauzi and Kulkarni. And they actually reduce their problem to solving a function in which the inner function is AND rather than XOR. And then they invoke tools and techniques from Shostov. Unfortunately, this, so we don't get much insight about XOR functions, and they also work only for symmetric outer functions. How do we analyze in general the unbounded error communication complexity of an XOR function, which is, so first let me tell you what our hard function, that decision list of equalities, what does it look like as an XOR function. So let's modify the odd max bit function slightly. Let's call it odd max bit 0. Look at the largest index, which is false, and output the parity of that. So this is what our function turns out to be, odd max bit 0 of OR of XOR. Okay. Now, here's how the proof outline is going to be. We wish to show that the sign rank of this f of XOR is large, right? That's what we want to show. The unbounded error communication complexity is large means the sign rank is large. Turns out that, so like I said, using some modification of the property that the eigenvalues of the matrices of XOR functions are just the Fourier coefficients of f. That's essentially what I mean by spectral properties of XOR functions. And Razborov and Shostov's modification of Foster's theorem, lower bounding the sign rank of a function in terms of the spectral norm, it turns out that if you want to show this, it suffices to show that there is a distribution mu, which is approximately smooth. I will make this slightly clearer on the next slide, I hope, under which f doesn't correlate with any parity. And it turns out that this property, which again I will make clearer on the next slide, Weierstrass LP duality is equivalent to this notion of f being inapproximable in a certain sense. Now this is sort of following the flow or outline of what previous works also do. So there have been a bunch of works on analyzing the sign rank of f with the inner gadget, which is a pattern matrix. So the pattern matrix method was introduced by Shostov. And there's been a bunch of works, one by Shostov, Razborov, Shostov, Bunn and Thaler, Buna et al., on analyzing sign rank of f of pattern matrix. And their analysis sort of follows the same flowchart, except for they just need that f correlates poorly with low degree parity. And the corresponding approximation theoretic problem they end up with is restricted degree in approximability result. And I'll mention a bit more of that. So first, now let me tell you what does this mean. So now this is our target. We want to show that f is inapproximable in a certain sense. This would imply sine rank of f of x is large. First, let me tell you what this looks like as a linear program. So you want a distribution mu. So this is you want it to be approximately smooth. So that means for some large set x, you want mu x to be close to uniform. So think of delta being the closeness to uniform. It's non-negative. And you want the correlation of f with the parity on the s to be small under mu. So you want to minimize epsilon such that. So this is essentially saying f mu hat of s is small for all s. And if you can show such a distribution mu with an optimal epsilon, then the sine rank lower bound obtained is the follows. So delta is like the smoothness parameter. And you need x to be really large. So basically, x complement has to be an inverse exponentially small fraction of the whole domain. In fact, I can tell you what x is, I should have told you. Notice that in this function, on a really large fraction of inputs, this OR is going to give you 1, right? And just using a union bound on a really large fraction of the inputs, all inputs feeding to this is going to be a 1, a true. So that's going to be our x. The set of all inputs such that the inputs coming to this odd magnitude 0 gate is 1 to the n. Turns out x complement is inverse exponential. So I hope this LP sort of makes sense. Okay, now what's the dual? How is f inapproximable? So there is going to be a lot of math on this slide, but let me try to break it down. So summation alpha s chi s of x is just the representation of a polynomial p. It's just a polynomial p of x, okay? And you want the coefficients of p, the sums of their absolute values, to sum up to at most 1. So the weight, the L1, the Fourier L1 weight of p is at most 1. In addition, you want p to approximate f well in the following way. P of x times f of x is greater or equal to delta for all x. So you want a worst case guarantee over all inputs. Now note this delta might be negative, which I'll come to in a while. But over this huge set X, which is almost the whole domain, you want an average case guarantee. So delta to be larger, I mean fx px has to be larger than delta plus some quantity here. And you're optimizing a sort of, some sort of combination of the two quantities, the worst and the average margin. Recall this. Now we need to show that f does not have such a good representation. So we're required to prove that f doesn't have a low weight good approximation. So the low weight part was here. So there's no good polynomial p of weight at most 1, but unrestricted degree. And the input domain is plus minus 1 for this function g of r. So approximation theoretic hardness of f, in this case f is odd max bit 0 of r, this outer function. That's the function we need to show in approximability for mention here that all of these previous works which I mentioned on the sine rank lower bounds for pattern matrix gadgets, they all had to work with restricted degree approximations. Now, in a sense, standard classical approximation theory looks a lot at restricted degree approximations, and there are a bunch of things known there. So this is one technical block barrier we had to face, is working with unrestricted degree. Another barrier which comes, which I will explain in a while, is we're required to prove an inapproximability result saying that a polynomial cannot represent a function. What this cannot represent is not even a sign representing representation, if I may say so. So you want a polynomial P, you want to say that no polynomial P can represent F in the following way. P of X times F of X might be negative at almost all points, but at a single point you want a really good guarantee. So something strong we're asking for. How would one typically want to argue against unrestricted degree polynomials? It's like, suppose you have a polynomial P which represents a function F in some way. Ideally, you'd like to hit everything with a random restriction. Okay, so randomly restrict the variables and hope that the approximating polynomial reduces in degree and the function F stays hard. Okay, unfortunately, over the parity basis, this doesn't really work out because the approximating polynomial does not drop in degree. So we use some techniques introduced by Krause and Kudlak in 98 to convert this to a problem over the OR basis, which is vulnerable to random restrictions. Okay. So a good approximation over the parity basis for G of OR gives us a good approximation over the OR basis for just G. And indeed, we hit it with a random restriction to get a good low degree approximation for G. Okay. And now low degree, at least, now we're finally in the regime against which we know sort of approximation theoretic results, like low degree inapproximability. So it turns out that when G is this function odd max bit 0, we can choose our random restriction suitably such that it sort of contains a large copy of odd max bit 0. Okay. Now, like I said, such a property was known to be false if you required signed representation. If you required a polynomial to sign represent odd max bit 0, then any low weight polynomial must have a bad error, let me put it that way. But it turns out that modifying the prior arguments of Beagle and Borman et al., that even if your polynomial is not necessarily sign representing, then you get the work. It's not possible. Let me quickly sketch the argument again. So we wish to prove a signed rank with lower bound against this whole function. And this flowchart tells us that it suffices to prove that this outer function is inapproximable in a certain way. And the way we prove that is we go via using tools and techniques from various places, we reduce this to a low degree approximation question. And ultimately, we want to prove that odd max bit 0 has no good restricted degree approximation over the OR basis, not in necessarily a sign representation. And modifying prior arguments, we show that this is not possible. So to conclude, what did I talk about? Are there any questions from you? So recall that we showed that there are functions in threshold of threshold which have large sign rank. So that means until this work it was like feasible that there are functions in threshold of threshold, that there are no functions in threshold of threshold of large sign rank. But unfortunately, we show that there are, unfortunately or fortunately. So that means the sign rank method may not be really useful against proving lower bounds in threshold of threshold, which was a possibility until this. We showed a communication complexity class separation. We showed that our function separating threshold of majority and threshold of threshold actually is in P to the MA. So P to the MA is not in UPP. So this implied a circuit separation. Threshold of majority is not in threshold of threshold. This actually also gives a new proof of sign rank lower bounds against AC0 functions. Because it turns out that this function here is in AC0. Odd max bit 0 can be shown to be representable by a depth 2 circuit type. And since these are parities on just constant bits, so AC0 is the class of constant depth, unbounded fan-in circuits of polynomial size, where the gates are just ANDs and ORs, and NOTs, let's say. So this can be converted to some small size circuits comprising of odds and ends. So the whole function is in AC0. So this sort of gives a new technique of sign rank lower bounds against functions in AC0. Although there were stronger sign rank lower bounds known earlier. So this decision list of equalities is a function in AC0. What forward or what stops. So the sign rank method might not be useful, like I said, against proving lower bounds against threshold of threshold, since this does have functions with large sign rank now. But let's see, we do identify a subclass of this, which is a natural candidate to, try to show lower bounds against. The class of decision list of exact thresholds. So exact thresholds being similar to linear thresholds, just replace the inequality by equality. So an exact threshold function is one if there are weights wi such that the function is true if and only if summation wi xi is equal to w0. Now what happens if we just consider decision list of equalities, since that's the function which we showed has large sign rank, right? But like I said, it's in AC0 and we have lower bounds against AC0. So let's look at the class decision list of exact thresholds. In fact, there is some, we do have some, there's a unpublished work showing lower bounds against decision lists of linear threshold functions along with others. But so that even provides more evidence that this might be a natural class to look at. So the natural goal. And I guess that's it. Thank you.
Questions? Maybe communication complexity side, but like the next thing up from P to the MA is maybe this S2P?
Yeah.
So this one is not separated from UPP?
P to the MA is in S2P, so our function is in S2P. So it's not even
all right, yeah.
Be short.
Right, okay. Cool. Any more questions?
Actually, just the simple approximation question, is it true? Like if I give you a matrix and I say, can you compute its sign rank? Is that a
I haven't looked into these type of questions actually.